continue, and I just want to start by thanking the 10 keynote lecturers for accepting our invitation. And most importantly, I want to thank you all for being here and making the conference possible. And without your contributions, nothing would be possible. And this is special after the sad events in the Ramblas 2 days ago that we very much appreciate to have received any cancellation of all the registered people. So thanks again for that. So the program is dense, contains 32 oral communications, 16 registered telegrams, and 8 people posters. And it reflects the high activity in the field. I said the program is dense, but I think that we'll have plenty of time in the afternoons for the poster presentations and discussions. Time to meet our friends, to make new colleagues, to plan new collaborations, maybe future projects. And this is the essence of any conference. And we expect the setup that we have prepared for you will foster precisely this. The conference is yours, and I think that we will have time to discuss other things around our community, and especially regarding the availability of new European supercomputing and networking infrastructures and services. I think that it's time to think about and make efforts to continue or to define a collective strategy for the years to come. I want to thank the sponsors of the conference, the companies SEM from Amsterdam, Mindabyte and HPC Now from Barcelona, Accelera also from Barcelona, the network of the Catalan network of theoretical chemists, and also I want to thank the Journal of Chemical Information and Modeling from the American Chemical Society for supporting us. Also I want to thank Wiley, especially Matteo Capaglieri, the editor-in-chief of the International Journal of Quantum Chemistry and the Journal of Computational Chemistry, who offered 3 awards for the 3 best posters, for the best poster of each session. The award is an amount of 200 euros in books for Wiley. So the scientific committee will organize in a way to decide the 3 awards. The 3 awards will be presented in the closing ceremony, right? And just also remind you that the Journal of Molecular Modeling will publish a special virtual issue from papers of the conference, and those interested in publishing in this special issue should contact Peter Selassie, who's not here today, or Ramon Sayos, who is over there. Ramon, please, is the editor for this special issue. And just before going to the first lecture, a couple of announcements for all speakers, keynotes, oral communications and research telegrams. Please upload the files before your session. Also for the posters, it's time already for display the posters, so please remove the posters after the final of the day. And finally, Barcelona is a very handy city, very easy city, but also say not fully safe for tourists, so keep your belongings under your control when you leave the room. And that's all, the conference is open, and I ask your first applause for our first speaker, Professor Walter Thiel.
Well, first I would like to thank you, Carlos, for the invitation, and also for the agreement that I should give a sort of broad overview lecture on quantum chemistry. So I would like to start with an old quote that most of you will know, Dirac: the underlying physical laws necessary for the mathematical theory of a large part of physics and the whole of chemistry are thus completely known, and the difficulty is only that the exact application of these laws leads to equations much too complicated to be solved. To realize this vision of Dirac, we start from a physics theory, quantum mechanics, which is correct in the realm of chemistry. We introduce approximate methods. We implement them in very large computer programs. We validate them and apply them to solve real problems in chemistry. And often enough, we find out that what we have is not good enough to solve these problems. So we have a feedback loop to make ever better approximate methods. And this strategy has led over the past decades to a hierarchy of successful methods, ranging from accurate ab initio methods to quite approximate combined multi-scale QMM methods. In our group, we work with all these methods, both in terms of development and applications. And so my plan for this lecture is just to take you through these methods in terms of typical applications in our group, in order to illustrate the status of the field and to discuss perspectives. So let's start with ab initio methods. This is the closest incarnation of Dirac's vision. We work on ab initio raw vibrational spectroscopy. That is, we do ab initio calculations as accurate as possible for the potential energy surface and the dipole moment surface. We then do variational calculations for nuclear motion, which yields raw vibrational wave function and raw vibrational energies. We combine this information with the dipole moment information to get intensities and to simulate the spectra. So one task is variational calculations of nuclear motion. This is essentially a solved problem. We have sort of written from scratch a program that does the variational calculation of such spectra. It allows us to compute the energy's intensity up to high J values. We can handle molecules with large amplitude motion, covers all types of coordinate basis sets, and it's quite it's general overall. So we can decide how accurate we want to solve the equations for nuclear motion and then get basically the spectral information. So the decisive factor for the overall accuracy then is the quality of the potential energy surface for electronic structure calculations. And empirically, we know from the standard in this field, coupled cluster CCSD parenthesis T, complete basis set limit, that we get wave numbers for all kinds of transitions, typically to within 5 wave numbers. We can push for higher accuracy, of course, by doing systematic improvements in the ab initio approach. The keywords are to add high-level corrections for higher order coupled cluster, maybe up to pentuples, for covalence correlation, for scalar relativistic effects, and for diagonal Born Oppenheimer contributions. And if we do that, we want to converge, of course, every single correction term in such an additive scheme. This shows you the results that we get with this approach for a simple molecule like ammonia. In red are the results from experimental results from a high-resolution spectroscopic database, HITRAN. And in green, you see the computed results ab initio with our TRAVI program. And you see on this scale perfect agreement, both for line positions and for intensities. In the rotational spectrum, in the complicated inversion part of the spectrum, in the bending and stretching regions, and also in the overtone regions. So we get an accuracy typically of one wave number in such calculations, and intensities that are probably as good as any experimental estimate. Such calculations of line lists have become popular in astrophysics recently. These are hot ammonia line lists from 300 Kelvin to 1500 Kelvin. And this can be used to study the atmospheres of exoplanets, a hot topic nowadays in astrophysics, to find out what is in the atmosphere by spectroscopic means. Over the past 2 or 3 years, this research in our group has taken sort of another slight turn, because there has been speculation that goes back to Dirac, 1937, that the natural constants may not actually be constant over the time that the universe exists, speculation. One of these constants is the proton to electron mass ratio. And of course, if this varies, then the raw vibrational energies will vary. And we should see that in raw vibrational spectroscopy. So there are two ways of detecting this experimentally: high precision laboratory experiments over a short time scale, 1 year, or astronomical observation of spectral lines at high redshift, looking back billions of years to the beginning of the universe. And the obvious question then is which molecular species and transitions should be studied, which are particularly sensitive. And here, theory is now good enough to make reasonable predictions. We have looked through our ammonia data, and we found, you know, that in the NU2, in the inversion band, there are certain subbands that would be very sensitive to such a shift of the proton to electron mass ratio. Anything T greater than 5 is large. And then we have systematically surveyed other transitions, and we find in the 2 nu 4 combination band, there are huge sensitivities. And so basically we can predict from theory measurements that sort of improve the limits on the constancy of the natural constants. And this research, I think, is best summed up in the editorial comment of the FISREF editor to read our paper. Row vibrational transitions in one of the isotopic ammonia molecules are calculated with high accuracy, where the orders of magnitude increase in the sensitivity to the constant of the proton to electron mass ratio revives the prospect of using this molecule to measure astronomical variations of this fundamental constant. Well, to put it in perspective, right now the limit is experimental that this constant changes by less than 10 to the minus 16 per year. But with these predictions, we can push that limit to 10 to the minus 17 or 10 to the minus 18, which is pretty esoteric for chemists. But I think astrophysics, you know, they are really hot on such things. From a theoretical point, I think it is reassuring that in a purely ab initio manner, we can demonstrate such high accuracy. We know basically that we get the right answer for the right reason. And I think coupled cluster theory in the single reference case is now something that, you know, is broadly applicable to chemistry. Used to be less than 10 atoms. Now with the linear scaling developments, DLPNOs, for example, we can do 100 atoms in a single point fashion easily. So what remains to be done in terms of perspective, I think, is the corresponding multi-reference extension of coupled cluster theory. Any single reference cases, we are, as a community, in very good shape to make very accurate predictions. So this is end of my first topic. So we now move from astrophysics back to Earth, to chemistry. So I live in this institute in Mülheim in Germany, which is a catalysis institute for Kohlenforschung. And my colleagues, they are all sort of hard-nosed experimental chemists. And we have collaborations with all of these groups in terms of elucidating reaction mechanisms of the reactions that they observe experimentally. So this involves work with Benjamin List on organocatalysis, with Alois Fürstner on transition metal catalysis, Manfred Reetz, biocatalysis, and so on, down to a biomass conversion with Ferdi Schütt. And we not only cooperate, but we also publish together. So the mere fact, you know, that my colleagues come back to us and come with new problems tells me that we sort of do something reasonable for them. The method that we are using basically is standard density functional theory, like many others of you will use. And I would just like to show you one example so that you have the flavor of what we do there. This is ruthenium catalyzed direct transhydrogenation, experimentally studied in the group of Alois Fürstner. They found that, for example, for this alkyne, if you add H2 with this ruthenium catalyst, you get a direct transhydrogenation, high yield and high specificity. And there are more examples with other substrates. And this, of course, is very surprising because sort of the textbook knowledge is H2 addition is in a cis fashion and not in a trans fashion. Moreover, what they found experimentally with this particular substrate, same catalyst, that they observe not only transhydrogenation, but also a ruthenium carbene intermediate, which was identified by NMR. And if they use this particular substrate, they even can sort of crystallize the carbene and get an X-ray structure. So without doubt, there is a channel that involves the carbene. So the question they ask to theory is, can you explain why trans and not cis, as it's the usual way? And what role does the carbene play mechanistically? So we used one particular DFT method, MO6, pretty standard everything after initial validation that this level is reasonable for the systems that we study. And now I have three slides to take you to the energy profile. We start out here with the reactants. We add we use a generic substrate, 2-butyne. So we add the substrate and H2. Then we have oxidative addition of H2 to get the dihydride that brings us up here. And then we basically go to the 1-vinyl species by shifting one hydrogen here. This is sort of the highest step in the whole profile that we have. And in this one vinyl, we have the stereo differentiation. You then form a three-membered ring, this ruthenium-carbon bond. And you can do that basically by twisting this moiety one way or the other way. If we do it in this way, we end up, if we do it like that, we end up basically with the E product, with a trans product. And then we twist here the other way around, we end up with a Z product, with a cis. And the essential point is that the rate limiting transition states for these two options are 3 kcal per mole better for the trans than for the cis, in agreement with experiments. So we can answer the first question, basically, why trans and not cis, by looking at these intermediates. So what about the carbene? You can also, in this intermediate E1 that I showed you before, you can formally twist around this ruthenium carbon bond and bring this hydrogen over here and then move the hydrogen to this carbon atom, which leads to the carbene product. And the essential point is that the two relevant transition states leading to the E and the carbene product, they are within 1 kcal per mole, basically. So this rationalizes why we have also, why we see also the carbene, basically. We have then looked what can the carbene do. All sorts of unimolecular rearrangements. The easiest way that it can do unimolecular is go back to where it came from, so not productive. However, the carbene can also, you know, undergo another hydrogen addition, and I don't go through all the details here. This leads via low energy transition states to butane and 1-butene, and these are the two side products that our experimental friends observed without knowing how they came about. So basically here the calculations gave sort of an indication how the side products were formed. So we also looked at the reaction of the actual substrate that went to the carbene, same catalyst again. This was the X-ray identified substrate. And also only the carbene intermediate, no hydrogenated product was found. And this we can rationalize again by looking at the same mechanism. Now the transition states, which differentiate between carbene formation and hydrogen addition, they have sort of a different energetic order. This one is favored. It's also much lower than before because of hydrogen bonding interactions in this moiety at the periphery. Once the carbene is formed, it can be stabilized by having an additional ruthenium-oxygen coordinative bond. So this carbene, which has been seen in the X-ray, is a thermodynamic sink. If we want to hydrogenate that in analogy to the side production, then we find that these are very high transition states. So the computations find a pathway to this stable carbene, and they also explain why it is stable. So to summarize this study, I know I went a bit fast on that, you know, but I just want to give you the flavor. For the model alkyne substrate, we can explain, you know, why it's trans and not cis, and we can explain why the carbene is formed with almost equal ease as the trans product, and we can rationalize the side products that have been seen experimentally. And for the real alkyne substrate, the formation of the carbene is very facile. It's a thermodynamic sink, and that explains why it can be seen by X-ray. So stepping back a little bit, you can ask yourself, are these DFT results really reliable? And I think this goes more towards the perspectives now. We can do many, many DFT studies successfully. The literature is full of these. But one should always remain critical and ask yourself, are these reliable? And what we've done here is checking these DFT results that we have through single point calculations with state-of-the-art linear scaling coupled cluster technology. And I think it is relatively reassuring, you know, that our best coupled cluster curve looks reasonably similar to the DFT curve that we've published. And this applies also to the second pathway, which leads to the side products. Again, the best, the DFT curves are pretty well reproduced with the best coupled cluster curves. And I don't want to go into the details. Of course, there are differences of the order of 1 or 2 kcal per mole. You can discuss these with your experimental friends. And then basically, the bottom line in this particular case is that couple cluster looks a bit better relative to experiment in a quantitative sense. But what I want to stress is that we have now the ability with these couple cluster single point calculations to nail down the energies to 1 kcal per mole. So the remaining error in terms of computational accuracy is the geometries that come from the DFT. Now stepping back still a bit further, I think we should not be, you know, too sort of exuberant about these results, because we do have more basic assumptions. We deal with model systems rather than real systems. Environmental effects will often be, you know, being covered very approximately, continuum solvation, for example. In larger systems, we have to grapple with conformational flexibility, finite temperature effects. Accuracy is an issue. So I think in this field, we will see more in the future in terms of multi-scale modeling, making better models, more sampling and free energy calculations, and I also mentioned, you know, single point local couple cluster treatments. So this is the end of part two of my talk. Now, I think we are in a rather comfortable situation with regard to ground state reactivity, as I've tried to show you. With regard to excited state reactivity, completely different problems pop up. So you work not with one potential energy surface, but with several potential energy surfaces. The electronic structure of most of these surfaces is intrinsically more difficult than ground state structures. We have to worry about how to get from one potential energy surface to the other one. Conical intersections play a real important role, a decisive role. And of course, if you pump in lots of energy, you know, of the order of 80 to 100 kcal per mole, then the short time dynamics of the system will become important, namely how does the system relax after photo excitation. And so I think it is appropriate not to focus on static treatments, but to go to dynamic treatments that you really follow dynamically for a few picoseconds the system directly after photo excitation. There are many approaches to do that. I think the most practical approach and probably also the most popular one is surface hopping, pioneered by John Tully in 1990, where you have a swarm of independent trajectories. Each of them moves on a single potential energy surface, but you allow for sudden hops between the surfaces by a few switches algorithm, typically. So what you do is basically you propagate this equation in time with inclusion of the non-adiabatic coupling with the dot product of nuclear velocities and the matrix element. We've implemented that already years ago in our semi-empirical MNDO code with sort of the typical options, few switches algorithm, decoherence correction. We also have a modular implementation in the QMMM package chemshell so that we can do the whole thing in an environment, in a protein, for example, or also with ab initio programs, because chemshell sort of has interfaces to other programs as well. This is quite established technology. We've improved that last year in one point that is practically important. If you do a multi-reference CI, which we do, semi-empirical multi-reference CI, sometimes the orbitals during the dynamics switch very quickly in certain regions of configuration space. So we have devised an adaptive time step algorithm that basically, you know, makes very small time steps in such critical regions so that the dynamics, the simulations do not break down. The bottom line is, you know, that correct trajectories into typical applications are now more than 90% of the trajectories could be used, whereas with the previous algorithm, we have to discard quite a few trajectories. I already mentioned we are doing that in our group at the semi-empirical MRCI level, which is really fast, so we can do many studies on medium-sized organic chromophores, and I've just listed here a few that we've done over the past, say, 10 years. And again, I would like to give you one example you know, what you get out of such calculations. This example is azobenzene. We did that a few years ago already. The cis form of azobenzene is twisted, so it's chiral, therefore, and it exists in two enantiomeric helical forms with plus and minus helicity. And now I would like to show you a short animation. basically after photo excitation, that's initial flash, how the system evolves on the excited state surface. Obviously, you know, to prepare you for this presentation, it can rotate about this NN double bond, either in one way or the other way, sort of typical photoisomerization, and we look at both processes both ways. Now let's see where this works. You see what happens now in the excited state is that basically this N2 moiety rotates and not much else happens. Now it became dark, it went down to the down state, to the ground state, and now sort of the Fennel rings, they unfold and they complete the isomerization. You probably know that there had been several mechanisms around, you know, discussed, and it is this bicycle pedal type mechanism, you know, with an initial rotation in the excited state, which we find in the simulations. So this is my first point, that by running such simulations, you can actually see which of possible mechanisms is realized experimentally. Now the next question is obvious, does it turn in both directions in the, with equal probability? And the answer is no. The P isomer that we had, 77% of the trajectories sort of keep the helicity, they are helicity conserving, so one particular rotation is favored over the other one. And, and this is sort of obvious if you look at the underlying potential energy surfaces. The helicity preserving pathway goes downhill more steeply than the other one, and that means that the other one has later access to the hopping region. And you see that in more detail if you look at the time distribution of the hops that you have in the helicity conserving P-channel clockwise. The system hops very quickly, sort of in the first approach to the conic intersection, whereas the non-helicity conserving M channel takes longer till it finds the region, the conic intersection region where it can hop. So you can zoom in that and you see basically that the decay is not exponential. Exponential decay is sort of the first approximation that we usually teach. Here it is modulated by some nuclear motion that is on the 50 to 60 femtosecond time scale. If you look at the vibrational spectrum of the compound, you find this corresponds to 600 wave numbers. You find around 600 wave numbers just this N2 rotation that I've seen you in the movie. So basically what we found in this paper is that Ohm-2 MRCI is in reasonable agreement with experimental and earlier theoretical studies. In parentheses, there are many experimental studies which due to time I could not really show you. I just want to highlight the things that are new in our study, sorry, that had not been seen before, namely that chiral pathways exist, the preferred channel maintains initial helicity, oscillatory patterns and hopping times, and a correlation with the NN rotation mode that acts as a promoting mode. Now, of course, having established now sort of a mechanism and having established that you can deal with these things, you can start playing chemistry and, for example, go to others, other derivatives. So here we have still a diazo bond, we have one Fennel ring, but here we have now pyrosol ring, another heterocycle. We can do the same games and we find in this particular system with two methyl groups here that 97% just rotate in one direction, helicity conserving, and 3% in the other direction. So basically this compound shows stereospecific unidirectional excited state relaxation, and in the in terms of constructing photo switches, I think this is an exciting possibility that you can sort of screen photo switches, potential photo switches computationally first, and basically suggest to experimentalists those that are most likely to perform well in terms of high selectivity. We've also looked some time ago at the famous Fehringer fluorine-based rotary motors. These are light-driven motors of this kind here that achieve repetitive unidirectional rotation by performing two photoisomerizations and two thermal isomerizations in each cycle. We have modeled the initial Fehringer system and we find excited lifetimes 1.4 and 1.8 picosecond and photostationary state ratios 2.7 to 1. These are good agreement with Fehringer's experimental numbers. And then we've asked ourselves, can we optimize these switches so that they sort of perform faster? And we can. We checked heteroatom substitution, how that affects the conical intersection. And we find that heteroatom substitution replace or put an N plus here instead of a C, that makes the conic intersection sort of an axial motion rather than a pyramidalized motion. And our trajectory show us that the lifetimes are then 200 femtoseconds, much faster than in the original system, 1400 femtoseconds. And also the quantum yields rise to 0.5 to 0.6 rather than 0.2 to 0.3. And again, helicity is always retained in these trajectories, successful design. So what I wanted to get across here at this stage is that ultra-fast photochemical reactions are well within the realm of what we can study and what we can simulate. We need dynamics treatments for that, and established is the dynamics treatment that I showed you since 10 years, sort of semi-empirical MRCI treatments. Of course, in the ab initio world, there have been many CAS SCF treatments, also coupled with dynamics, which I would not trust so much because ab initio CAS SCF gets the relative position of excited states mostly wrong because it neglects dynamic correlation, which basically means that the dynamics will not be realistic. But the perspective here is that I just heard that last week at the WATO conference in Munich, that Togo Shigaraki has now basically implemented an analytical MS-CAS-PT2 gradient and has also basically the corresponding non-adiabatic coupling matrix elements available. So this will be much more expensive, but also much more accurate than a semi-empirical MRCI. So I think the perspective here is that we will see in the future quite a bit sort of CAS-PT2 based dynamics of ultra-fast processes, and that we move on towards more accuracy also in these systems and more generality. So going back to the ground state, what I had shown you is, what I had shown you is that we can do ground state reactions of catalysis pretty well, but these were model systems of the order of 100 atoms that we had, maybe 50 to 100 atoms. Now another layer of complexity, of course, is go to biochemistry and look at the reactivity of enzymes in the ground state or in the excited state. And this, of course, can be done nowadays with multi-scale QMM methods, where the important part, the active site, is treated by QM as accurately as needed, and the environment by, at a lower level, say, force field level. We have been active in that field for quite a while, and we have put up together with UK collaborators a modular QMM package called ChemShell, where all the QMM-specific control routines are handled in at this central module level, and then you have interfaces to your favorite QM and MM codes, which makes this approach very feasible and applicable in many parts of chemistry. In the area of biomolecular modeling, I think one can say that there is a consensus QMM approach that has emerged. Total system size, 10,000 to 40,000 atoms, including the solvent, so the enzyme in a solvent ball. An active site QM region, typically 50 to 100 atoms. Standard DFT as QM components, standard force fields as MM, electrostatic embedding, so that the QM part can sort of reorganize, relax in response to the polar groups around. QMM boundary, typically treated by link atom scheme, hydrogen atoms, and the normal, or the most popular way of approaching this, that is to take a few snapshots from MD calculation, compute reaction path and energy profiles, and then discuss reactivity and mechanism. All this summarized in our Angewandter review. Of course, there are improvements of this consensus approach, larger active site QM regions, higher level correlated ab initio methods as QM components, dispersion corrections, polarized force fields and polarized embedding, more refined boundary treatments, say pseudopotentials, and very important proper sampling through molecular dynamics in Monte Carlo, which allows you to go from energy profiles to free energy profiles, adaptive QMM partitioning in MD studies, extension to the excited state, three-layer QMM continuum approaches, periodic boundary conditions. Again, we have done over the past years quite a few studies on ground state enzyme reactivity. Our favorite has been cytochrome P450, where we have more than 25 papers. And this shows you this list that, you know, you can do these studies on a fairly standardized manner and get conclusions about enzyme mechanisms. I don't want to talk about any published work here, but spend my last three or so minutes on just something that we are doing right now, enzyme-catalyzed Diels-Alder reactions. I mean, Diels-Alder is sort of the reaction in organic synthesis, you know, to make six-membered rings. But the question is, has nature evolved enzymes that do these Alder reactions? There have been quite a few claims, but no real proof. And the best probably candidate is biosynthesis of spinosine A by this enzyme SpinF. And this basically catalyzes cycloaddition reactions in this part of the molecule. This is sort of the outcome of the molecule, the calculations, in a sequence of enzymatic reaction where you have this and this new bond, formerly 4 plus 2 and 6 plus 4 cycloaddition. There's this X-ray structure since 2015, which is sort of the starting point of our investigation. There have been model studies, and I like a beautiful paper by Dan Singleton and Ken Hauck, where they have at the DFT level localized the transition states, and they have basically shown through MD studies that there is one initial transition state that is rate determining, and thereafter in dynamics, the system branches to Diels-Alder and a 6 plus 4 adduct. And you see that in this ambimodal transition state, they find a length of the forming bonds of 3.0 and 2.98 angstrom. So it's about equally probable that these two are formed in the reaction. They show this diagram of the energies, and they found out that dynamically, even the 6 plus 4 is favored in the gas phase as a model compound in the 2.5 to 1 ratio. So we thought it's worthwhile to look at that at the QMMM level and have the normal QMMM setup. This is all standard for us. I rushed through that because time's running out. This is the QM region basically that we use, the substrate with some key active site residues around it. Again, more or less standard protocols. The first thing that we see in these QMMM calculations is that in the gas phase, the key bonds are in a trans configuration. The C5C6 bonds in the diene unit, and also C1O22 in this upper part. And when we go to the enzyme, we see that there is lots of hydrogen bonding up here, which changes the configuration up here basically, such that preferred is now a cis in this region of the molecule. And as a consequence, if you look at our best numbers, the cis and the trans configuration at the reacting diene CC double bond are about equally equally stable. So basically, one factor is that the enzyme prepares the reaction through interactions with the environment. And then if you look at the transition states that we located, in the key transition state C7 to C11, this is the bond that is formed in either cycloaddition. This remains short, so it's basically as short, a bit shorter even, in the enzyme than in the gas phase. This R2, C4, C12, which is formed in the Diels-Alder addition, this is now shorter in the enzyme than in the gas phase. And R3, basically the CC bond that is formed, the 6 plus 4, is much longer in the enzyme than in the gas phase. And this has to do again with the hydrogen bonding up here, where the hydrogen bonding interactions here and here that pull this part apart in the enzyme, this part of the molecule, as evidenced by this OO distance that arises from 4.2 in the gas phase to 5.0 in the enzyme. So basically we see from this transition state structure already that the enzyme favors Diels-Alder over 6 plus 4. And this is the corresponding energy diagram. We do have catalysis because the energy barrier is lowered. and we only find in our searches the 4+2 path in the enzyme and not the 6+4 path. We can explain that by natural population analysis of the charges in the molecule. We have run free energy simulations at the semi-empirical ohm 2 charm level, which fit into the picture. And I just would end this fourth part by saying that the QMM study provides strong evidence that the enzyme SpinF indeed acts as the first bona fide diels-aldolase. So more general, I think we have the methodology now available to do enzymatic reactions successfully. It's not yet black box. I think the perspectives are including higher level QM components and sampling techniques. And I think this type of approach is essential for doing chemical reactions and also electronic excitations, more generally for cheating electronic events in complex systems. So my final slide, quantum chemistry, generalities. I think we should not be too modest at this stage after decades of development. In terms of accuracy, we should strive to be as good as or better than experiment. And we can do that, I think, with ab initio copper cluster treatments already now. We, in terms of complexity, we should be able to handle real-world systems. And in terms of robustness, quantum chemistry method should be generally applicable to all of chemistry. And of course, an underlying theme is soundness, getting the right answer for the right reason. The people that did the work, this is my group. I think I don't have time to go through everyone. I should just mention Alec Owens did the ab initio vibration rotation spectroscopy. Larry Wolf did the the DFT study of ruthenium catalysis, and Yiqing Zheng did the Diels-Alderberg. And thank you very much.
Very interesting, as usual. So I'm just curious, the first part in the astrophysics part, you told us that now you are ready to know if the concepts are now. Okay, so in the astrophysics part, you told us that with proper methods you can really distinguish these very fine details, but are the experiments there to, so I'm curious about really these constants have changed or not, or so what is the current status there?
Well, there is an active community pursuing these questions in high resolution spectroscopy, and of course they, we have in the FISREF paper that I cited, we have gone through possible lab experiments to check that. They have not yet been done because the paper was out last year. So I think it will be. It is taken seriously by the experimental colleagues, but no results have appeared yet. I think my point is simply we are confident enough of our results really to put that in print and say, please check it. Yeah. I think they are great, you know. They are benchmark methods, basically, to find out the right answer. Of course, there are many flavors of quantum Monte Carlo methods. The one that impresses me most is the work by Ali Alavi recently, where he uses quantum Monte Carlo to approach full CI calculations by moving around in Hilbert space in a Monte Carlo fashion. On the other hand, you can also do that without quantum Monte Carlo, but you can do sort of iterative CI where you just check the pathways which state or which configuration is coupled to which one, and then basically build up a sort of a full CI space approximately also in a more deterministic fashion. So I think complementary methods, you know, and they are here to stay, of course, yeah.
Impressive. Talk. My question is about the last part of your talk about biomolecular simulations. Okay, you have presented a case and you have compared the free energy barrier, the theoretical free energy barrier, with experimental results. My problem is, if you generate along molecular dynamic simulations, for instance, along 100 nanoseconds, we will obtain a very great dispersion of initial structures, and probably from this dispersion we will obtain a very high, a very big dispersion of energy barriers. The way to combine all these different energy barriers could be making free energy calculations, but along the free energy calculations you are using windows with a length of just a few picoseconds. The problem is, do you think that the free energy calculations using windows of picoseconds can represent the problem along many nanoseconds? As a matter of fact, this is related with the famous sentence of Dirac that you have mentioned in your first slide.
Yeah. Well, let me first say that I think that sampling is probably the largest problem we have still. I mean, quantum chemists worry most about sort of single point accuracies, but I think if you get to complex systems like enzymes, sampling is sort of an all important issue. Then, I mean, when we do free energy calculations, we do that, of course, along reaction pathways that have been optimized. And again, there you do it for a few of such pathways, and there is quite a bit of chemical intuition sort of needed, how to select the initial conditions and which pathways to choose and so on. And chemical intuition can always be wrong in this case. So I think you raise very important caveats. I think technically it's okay there for the pathway along which you sample that we can converge the results. But whether we can converge the results with regard to what happens in nature is a different question, because we may not have sort of taken the right initial conditions. Let me phrase that very broadly. And then if you have several sets of results, you know, you still have sort of the question of how to average them if you're a barrier, sort of arithmetic averaging, exponential averaging, doing something else. I think there's lots to be done, which means job security for all of us, yeah.
Okay, Nassos. Yeah, you mentioned CASPT2 as a potentially more accurate method. How do you feel about DMRG? And do you plan on implementing DMRG in your semi-empirical tool set?
Second question, no. The reason simply is because in semi-empirical methods, the dynamic correlation is conceptually included by the integral approximations and by the parameterization. So basically, we can always get by with a relatively small CI. The first question, CASPT2, well, it doesn't save us solve all the problems, of course, but it is the de facto standard now that we have in sort of medium-sized excited state calculations. And it will be very interesting to see, you know, what the dynamics results with MS-CASPT2 will be. I would rate them more accurate than what we have right now. But of course, they are maybe 10,000 times more expensive, you know. But, you know, with time, you know, we will get more and more results. I mean, the limiting factor there will be the choice of the active space, of course. And it remains to be seen how sensitive, you know, CASPT2 dynamics will be on the choice of the active space. I think this is the biggest hurdle that one has, because I would tend to believe, you know, that CASPT2 needs larger active spaces than semi-empirical MRCI. Okay, I don't
and
know.
You don't think that DMRG will solve this problem, the space size of the space problem?
I don't even know whether DMRG people have gradients and non-adiabatic coupling for dynamics, yeah? I haven't seen gradients, for example.
Yeah, you're right. I don't think they have.
And then we can't do it in dynamics, yeah?
Then one last question, looking into the future. What about quantum computing? We talk technology.
I'm very skeptical, frankly, but I'm too old for that, probably. I mean, I've heard talks by Alan, and he said, you know, we'll be ready in 2035, and I'm happy if I live then still.